Good morning, and welcome to Greater Roles of Sharon Sunday morning service. Join us on Facebook Live at 10 a.m., and it will be repeated at 11 Sunday morning. Also, you can watch it in a rerun on YouTube at 6 p.m. So sit back, get your Bibles out, and join us for Sunday morning with Pastor Sedrick Cross at the Roll.
We praise you.
Walking around in the day, and an angel fell before you with love and grace. Oh Lord. Around in the day, and an angel fell before you with nothing but grace. Oh Lord.
Good morning, Greater Rose. Today's scripture is coming from James 1, verse 17. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Let's pray. Father God, here it is once again that we come to your house to say thank you, Father God. Thank you for waking us all up this morning, Father God, because we know it was only you, Father God. Lord, we come to you right now asking for prayer, but not only for this church, but for everyone in this church individually and via Facebook Live. Lord, we pray for everybody who's on their way and everybody who's not only watching, but hearing also, Father God. Lord, please bless the souls of everybody right now, Father God. Keep our faith strong in you, Father God. Please bless everybody inside this house, Father God, and every other house across the world, Father God. And Lord, I pray for Pastor Cross and his family, Father God, on this day, Father God. Keep them safe. Keep them touched, Father God. Let them know that you never leave their side, Father God. And everything works together for the good for them who loves the Lord, Father God. Please bless him, Father God. Bless his family, Father God. Bless his wife, Father God. And bless every other family in this church and across the world, Father God. Lord, I pray as you lead this service, Father God, we pray if you could touch it and bless it, Father God. Make this service the service you want it to be, Father God, on this day. today, Father God. And Lord, I come right now, I'm praying for every church, Father God, that stands bold in your name, Father God. And I would love to pray for this choir as you bless their souls and bless their voices, bless their heart, Father God, so they can sing praises to your name, Father God, because you are worthy of all praise, Father God. Lord, not only that, we ask if you not only touch us, Father God, but you could keep us in the palm of your hands, Father God. And Lord, I just want to say thank you. Thank you, and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray, let us all say amen.
Morning, Greater Rose. I have the honor to, I have 5 minutes to try to inspire you.
Go ahead.
And the only way I know how to inspire children of God It's through the word of God. So this morning, I want to inspire us to be trees of that produce fruit. You do know that God has planted us in certain areas to produce fruit. We're not trees that just somebody just threw an apple outside of the road and then just happened to just, the seed just happened to grow right there. We were intentionally planted in specific spots to produce fruit. Now, one thing about a tree has to go through certain things in order to be productive. We got the seasons. A tree has to deal with the heat in the summertime, the cold in the wintertime, the storm through the stormy season, tornadoes. A tree has to endure all those things. And that's just like us. In our lives, we're going to have stormy situations. We're going to have the heat that's going to get turned up on us. But we still have to stand strong and be a tree of production. Now, another thing about trees. If you go to Luke, I think it's the 13th chapter, around the 6th verse, the owner of the vineyard had come to the vineyard, and he was looking at this tree, fig tree. Now, the tree was, the owner said he had been coming for 3 years, but the tree hadn't produced fruit. Now, that lets me know one thing. The tree was mature enough to produce fruit, because if it had not have been mature enough, the owner would not have expected fruit. Okay. Now, in order for the tree to produce fruit sometime, there has to be dung spread around it. That's what the word of God said, dung, or fertilizer. We just going to call it stuff today, okay? So in order for us to be fruitful trees that produce sometimes, God is going to allow us to be circled with stuff. Stuff that stinks, stuff that's dirty, stuff that's nasty, but it's important for our production. One more thing, and I'm going to sit down. Another thing a tree needs in order to be productive, it has to be pruned. What do I mean? The dead parts of the tree, or the sick parts of the tree have to be cut off, has to be removed. Because if you don't remove the dead stuff, if you don't remove the sick stuff, it's going to suck all the nutrients from the live stuff, from the healthy part of the tree. And the tree will suffer. I'm not going to lie to you. When you get cut and God starts pruning you, it's going to hurt, y'all. But it's necessary. So as we are trees planted by God to produce fruit. Now, if you are a tree and you're not producing fruit, you're just throwing shade.
Let every heart say amen. Say amen again. Amen. If you're happy to be in the house of the Lord, come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise. For we know that today is the day that the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. We give all praise and honor to God the Father, to His Son, who is Jesus the Christ, and to the Holy Spirit, our comforter and our guide. I'm sure you would agree with me when I say that it's good to be here. Amen. Somebody laid down last night, didn't wake up this morning, but God saw fit to allow you and I to see another day. And for that, we ought to be thankful. Amen. Let us pray. Master, we come now in the name of Jesus. We thank you, we praise you, we bless your name, Father God, for you are worthy to be praised. Father, we thank you for allowing us to assemble in the house of prayer once again. Master, we ask for forgiveness of our sins and shortcomings, Lord. And now, God, as I stand to proclaim your good news on this day, we pray, God, that the Spirit of the living God would fall fresh in this place. I pray, Master, that you would hide me behind the shadow of Calvary's cross. We pray, Lord, that your word would fall on good ground on this day. And if there be someone here or even tuning in via Facebook Live that stands in need of a Savior, we pray, God, that you would move by your Spirit on this day and touch the heart of a sinner that they may be saved. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we bless your name, God. It's in the matchless name of Jesus, your Christ, that we pray and ask it all. Amen. Amen. Once again, why don't you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Amen. And we give all praise and honor to God the Father and to His Son, who is Jesus, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. Listen, all is well. Let me say it again. All is well. Amen. For those who don't know, this past Friday, God called Mother home to be with Him. Amen. We are taking one day at a time, but as I say, all is well. Listen, when you pass on and you know where you're going, that's all right. Amen. Amen. We thank God for Him continuing to keep us during this time. And just, if you would, just keep us in your prayers. Amen. 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 So this morning we are going to be in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. And those of you, if you have your Bibles, if you would, turn to Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. And if you have it, let it be known by saying amen. Acts chapter 2. And we're going to begin reading at verse number 1, where it says, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them." Verse 4 says, "And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance." Amen. I want to talk for a little while this morning from the subject, the birth of the church. The birth of the church. Let's all say amen. Now, so often I have said, you have heard me say, that we should not ever overlook or underestimate the power, the presence of the ministry of the Holy Spirit. It is not possible to do what God has called us to do without the Holy Spirit in us and with us. Now, whatever task you have, you need the right tools to complete the task. If you're going to build, you need the right materials. If you're going to prepare a meal, you need the right utensils. If you're going to serve in ministry in any form, you need the Holy Spirit. And when we look at where we are in our text on today, we see that the Spirit on the day of Pentecost, he has come just as he was promised. In the past few weeks, we've been preaching from Easter all the way up to the day of Pentecost. And some wonder, well, what was the real purpose behind Pentecost? What was the real reason for Pentecost? Well, in a short version, we could just say that the Spirit came to give strength and power to believers. But God was fulfilling a promise by sending the Spirit. You do remember Jesus told his disciples that it is expedient for you that I go away. Letting them know it was good. They didn't see it at the time. But he was letting them know it is good, it is for your benefit that I go away. Because Christ let them know that if I don't go away, that the Spirit can't come. You see, one couldn't overlap the other. As long as Jesus was with them, their focus would have been on Jesus. Keep in mind, the 3 years he ministered, they ate with Jesus. They slept when Jesus slept. They went where Jesus went. They prayed when Jesus prayed. They heard every sermon preached, so they had gotten accustomed to Jesus being with them. But they did not realize all of the details of the divine plan. So Christ let them know that, listen, it's expedient for you that I go away, because if I don't go away, the Spirit can't come. So just as the Word had promised that the Comforter would come, here we are in Acts chapter 2. And it says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And it's a good thing, brothers and sisters, for the church to be on one accord. And in the text, now, when we think of the church, keep in mind that this is the birth of the New Testament church. We're not talking about a mega church with 1,000 members. This was just a few of those followers of Christ that were assembled in an upper room. As a matter of fact, if we look at Acts chapter 1, verse number 13, and when they were come in, they went up into an upper room where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon Zealous, and Judas the brother of James. Verse 14 says, they all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brethren. So those that were assembled here on the day of Pentecost, it was not a large crowd. But they were in one place and they were on one accord. And it wasn't hard for them to be on one accord, because they were together as they were. Jesus was after he was crucified. And then they were there to received the Great Commission as Christ stepped on a cloud, before he stepped on a cloud and ascended back to the Father. And now, here they are on the day of Pentecost in one place on one accord. And verse 2 says, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. Now, the text doesn't say that the Spirit was a mighty rushing wind. It says a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. So they were in a specific place on one accord. And based on what the Bible is teaching, the Spirit of God, it filled the room where they were. And this was the set time for the Lord to send the Holy Spirit. And people from many different places were in Jerusalem celebrating the Festival of Weeks. And the disciples, they were gathered in the upper room, and we can see the fulfillment of Luke chapter 3, verse 16, where it says, John has a saying to all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. So John, we know John's baptism. John baptized with water. Yes, sir. Yeah. But he says, listen, there's another one coming. And he's going to baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire. And when we think about the Old Testament, the Spirit of God came upon me. In the Old Testament, God gave his power selectively. The prophets, the judges, Moses, Samson, whomever he so chose, he gave them power to complete a specific task. And the Spirit that came upon them empowered them to do that which God had called them to do. The Spirit of God came upon men, but now men are filled with the Spirit. And it's a blessing to know, and we've been talking about it for a few weeks, but it is a blessing to know that the Spirit of God is alive on the inside of every believer. Now, these were disciples. They were all assembled together. They were followers of Christ. They were assembled in one place. And the Spirit came as a mighty rushing wind. Now, there's a lot of meat in the text. We won't try to cover it all, but there's some things we got to point out. You see, there are some who teach. Y'all follow me now. There are some that teach based on these verses, based on the scriptures, that there is a such thing as belief in Jesus, and at some other time, the Spirit then comes. Let me say that again. There's some teaching out here, and some that believe that you can believe in Jesus, but then at some point after your belief in Christ, then comes the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. There are people that believe, just as in the text before Pentecost, we had to make mention of those in chapter 1 that are now assembled in the upper room together. They were followers of Christ. But keep in mind, as we chronologically go through Scripture, the Spirit has not yet come. So the disciples and the women, Mary and the other women and Jesus' brethren, all of them were followers of Christ. But they weren't filled with the Spirit because he hadn't come yet. And there are some who hang to this doctrine and this belief even now, that it's possible to believe and at some other point then comes the Spirit. Well,
What we're seeing in the text is an event that happened, and this is the Spirit, his dispensation. Now is the coming of the Holy Spirit, and he makes his arrival. And now the New Testament church is being established. And so we're no longer in a time where we have a belief in Jesus and at some other point the Spirit comes. Based on Paul's definition of and how he describes the plan of salvation in the book of Romans, listen, if we confess with our mouth, believe that Jesus died and rose again on the third day, the Bible says, thou shalt be saved. And at that point that you put your faith in Christ Jesus, that is when the Spirit took up resident on the inside of all of us. Listen, if there was a such thing as belief in Christ, and then a period afterwards where we were indwelled with the Spirit, then there would be something in here that we can read to verify that. Matter of fact, since we know the Spirit is our teacher and our guide, if we had our belief in Jesus and the Spirit came at some point afterwards, well, how are we making it in the meantime? How are we reading the Scripture and getting any understanding if we got to wait on the Spirit to come? How do we change the way we talk and the way we walk if the Spirit isn't on the inside? You see, sometimes we can just take a practical approach to some things to get an understanding. Listen, we would still be doing the things we were doing when we were out in the world if it were not for the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. Yes, there wouldn't be any change in the way we walk, the way we talk, the way we think, if it were not for the Lord living on the inside of us by way of the Holy Spirit. Yes, so it is just not sound doctrine to say that we can have a belief in Christ and be identified as a Christian, and then sometime later, 2 months, 2 years, 20 years from now, then the Spirit comes. It just doesn't line up. And now, granted, now that's the Spirit lives on the inside of us. For some of us, it'd take a little while to start obeying him. It's not that he isn't fair, and it's not that he isn't convicting us, but some of us took a little longer to get in line with what the Spirit is saying. But it is not doctrinally sound to say that you're a believer in Christ, and then, you know, a little while from now, then the Spirit will come and take up residence on the inside. It's not like Amazon. You can order some from Amazon and they'll tell you what day is coming. You can order some from Amazon today. They'll tell you to be at your house Tuesday by 3 o'clock. And they're pretty good about it. When they say it's coming, it'll be there. Well, listen, that's not the case with the Spirit. Where you set your belief in Christ and then the Spirit come on some other time. Listen, at the time you said yes to the Lord, when you gave your heart to him, that's when the Spirit took up residence on the inside of us. And we can believe, even though you may not have a certain feeling. I said this in a few sermons ago that, listen, it wasn't a parade when the Spirit took up residence. They didn't release balloons. It wasn't fireworks when the Spirit took up residence. But just know, when you gave your heart to the Lord, that's when the Spirit of God moved on in. And when you began to change, see a change in the way you talked. When you began to see a change in the way you walked. When you began to see a change in the way you thought. The only reason there was a change is because the Holy Spirit was working on you on the inside. Yes, there were people there at Pentecost that believed in Jesus before Pentecost, but they did not receive the Holy Spirit until Pentecost. Yes, And this is why there is special significance of the day of Pentecost. This was his, the Holy Spirit. This was his arrival. And this event laid the foundation of the New Testament church. So we must understand that this is not the process for us right now and for believers that will come after this event. The Spirit took up residence on the inside when we said yes to the Lord. Somebody ought to say amen. And when we look at what's taking place in the text, let's look at verse 2 again. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. Now, let's look at, well, let me read verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, some of y'all probably know what I'm finna deal with. Now, it says, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like us as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, we just pointed out that in Jerusalem at the time, they were celebrating the Feast of Weeks. And there were many people at Jerusalem at the time coming from all different places. And the text says, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues. Now, tongues can be translated as language. So when it talks about them speaking in other tongues, they spoke in other languages. And the reason, and you can verify this in verse number 6, it says, now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. It uses the word tongues in verse 4, but it uses the word language in verse 6. And people coming from all different places, all across the world, they heard this. The Spirit spoke to the disciples, and they were all being used by God, speaking in other tongues, in other languages. So therefore, the people that came from different regions, different areas, they heard the disciples being used as witnesses in the language that they spoke. This was not some inaudible utterance that no one could understand. The tongues is just a different way of translating language. So they spoke in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave utterance. So why is this significant? Because we're talking about Jews, Galileans, that had been following Christ. They were all in Jerusalem. They weren't from everywhere. We're talking about a handful of Jews. And when the Spirit spoke to them, and when the fire, the cloven tongues, it was symbolic of the presence of the Holy Spirit, it says that they spoke and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So the Spirit allowed them to speak in languages that the people that were present could understand. I don't mean to be offensive, but it wasn't some gibberish that folk couldn't understand. They spoke in a language, real words, that people understood. And as a result, those that were present, see, God has a way of setting things up. This was the Feast of Weeks where thousands of people were in one place. So I suppose God said, well, since y'all all here, let me move upon the 12, 14, 15 that were in the upper room. And he spoke to them, and they began to speak in the languages that everyone could understand. And after the celebration of the Feast of Weeks, everyone went back to where they came from.
Yeah. Yeah.
And what they experienced on the day of Pentecost,
yeah,
they took back to the places where they came from.
Yeah. Yeah.
This began this set the stage for the growth of the New Testament church. Now there are other things that happen on the day of Pentecost. A couple of things I need to show you. Now in Acts chapter 8, verse number 14, there were what one Bible teacher says that there were four classes of people. You had your Jews, you had your Gentiles, you had the believers. Keep in mind that we're transitioning from the Gospels into the book of Acts. So you had believers that believed in Christ. We pointed out the ones that are in the upper room, but there were others who saw him feed the multitude. There were others who remember him raising Lazarus from the grave. There were others who believed that we see in the Gospels. But now we're in the book of Acts, and there are other believers other than those that were gathered in the upper room. So you have the Jews, you have the Gentiles. Gentiles are those who didn't believe. You have the believers who we see that followed Christ from the Gospels. Then you have the Samaritans. We know the Samaritans were the mixed breeds, you know, Jew, Gentile. So in the Samaritans, Acts chapter 8, verse 14. Now watch what it says. Now when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them, who, when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus.
Yes,
then they laid hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So the Samaritans, they had the word of God. They heard about Jesus. But what happened in Acts chapter 2 hadn't reached them in Acts chapter 8.
Yeah, yeah, right.
So what took place at Pentecost, the initial filling of the Holy Spirit, the coming of the Holy Spirit. Now the same disciples, apostles, who were filled with the Spirit in chapter 2, now they've gone to work.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Now in chapter 8, they have come across some of Samaritans. And the text says, Samaria had received the word of God. They sent Peter and John to them, who, when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. They had the word, but they hadn't received the Spirit yet. So what the Lord did is he had his original disciples in the upper room. And after they were filled with the Spirit, keep in mind, he has already given them the Great Commission. So now they are off going to work. And in chapter 8, they run across Samaritans who they had come across the word of God, and they knew about Jesus, but they hadn't received the Spirit because that took place in chapter 2. Now, because of the ones that received the Spirit, they laid hands on them. And now they have received the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 10, beginning at verse 44, the Gentiles. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word.
Yeah.
And those of the circumcision who believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also.
Yeah.
For they heard them speak with tongues, yes, and magnify God. So in Acts chapter 10, the Gentiles, Peter was preaching the word of God to them. And the Spirit, just as he did in Acts chapter 2 and in Acts chapter 8, now they are filled with the Spirit. And what we have to understand, we have to keep in mind that this is the establishment of the New Testament church. This is what paved the way to places like Greater Rose of Sharon.
Yeah.
We are the church. This is the place where we assemble.
Yeah.
But the church is every believer everywhere.
Yeah.
And in order for this to get established, listen, God took the time to deal with his original apostles. And when they were filled with the Spirit, they were obedient to the Great Commission. And when they went out, in Acts chapter 8, we see them introducing people who they knew about Jesus, but they hadn't been filled with the Spirit. So when they laid hands on them, the apostles laid hands on them, they were filled with the Spirit. The Gentiles, the same thing happened in Acts chapter 10. Then in Acts chapter 19, beginning at verse number 1, and it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? Then they said, we have not so much as heard of the Holy Spirit. And he said to them, into what then were you baptized? And they said, into John's baptism. Then Paul said, John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Once again, keeping in mind the foundation is being laid for the New Testament church. And Paul asked a question. He says, listen, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And I mean, they were sincere. We ain't even heard of the Holy Spirit. You know? Why? Because what happened in Acts chapter 2 hadn't reached Acts chapter 19 yet. So here we see the progression of what took place at Pentecost on the day of Pentecost. We see the Spirit moving in Acts chapter 8. We see him moving in Acts chapter 10. And here it is in Acts chapter 19. They were believers. Keep in mind, we're leaving the gospel and transitioning over into the book of Acts. And here they are, folks who had heard about Jesus, believed in Jesus, but Pentecost hadn't happened yet. And then Paul ran across these believers and said, listen, did y'all receive the Holy Spirit? And they said, man, we ain't even heard of the Holy Spirit. And that's when Paul ministered to them in the same way Peter did, laying hands on them, and then they began to speak. When it talks about tongues, we're talking about language. They began to prophesy and speak and be witnesses of the Lord Jesus. So all of us that are believers, we have been filled with the same Holy Spirit. And we should be actively engaged in being a witness for Christ. We see Paul, we see Peter, and it may not mention everyone in the upper room by name, but everyone that was filled with the Spirit, they got on fire for the Lord, and as a result, the church grew by large numbers. And the same commission that was given to those that were present when Jesus went back to the Father applies to you and I. So now I got to call you out. Listen, just because you're shy, you don't talk much, you don't do crowds, listen. The same Holy Spirit that indwelled these folks at the day of Pentecost lives on the inside of all of us. And we are able to be a witness for Christ, not by our own strength, knowledge, boldness, or courage, but because of the Holy Spirit who works on the inside of all of us. We're talking about the same Spirit that went to work in Acts chapter 2, that went to work in Acts chapter 8, went to work in Acts chapter 10, went to work in Acts chapter 19. This is the same Spirit that lives on all of us. And because of the work and the ministry of the Holy Spirit, all of us can have an impact on the kingdom of God.
Yeah, right.
Everybody is not called to preach. But we can all be a witness. Everybody has something you can share with somebody about the goodness of God. You may not be able to break down the book of Acts, but you can tell somebody what the Lord has done for you. And you can give the facts of the Bible, but you want to touch somebody's heart, tell them how the Lord brought you out. See, we've heard he was a healer. But you need to tell him about that time when you were sick. Now you know him as a healer. Now we know he's a provider. But you need to tell him about that time you were broke. You know, we know he's a heart fixer, mind regulator. But you need to tell him about that time you almost went crazy. But if it had not been for the Lord that was on your side, where would we be? We have all got something to tell about the goodness of God. And we can tell him about how he hung, bled, and died, rose again on the third day with all power in his hand, and that he is alive right now, seated at the right hand of the Father, waiting one day to return to receive his church. We're talking about the early church, the New Testament church that we're all a part of. This same spirit that trailblazed the way for Jesus' church is alive in all of us. And don't you let Satan trick you into thinking that you don't have anything to say, that you're not going to make a difference in the kingdom building process. These were all what the Bible talks describes as ordinary and unlearned men. And God working through them, they reached the masses. They didn't have to wait until they graduated seminary. They didn't have to be the most educated, influential people. They had a willingness to be used by God, and the Holy Spirit worked in them and through them. And that message, here's the thing that blow your mind. What happened in Acts chapter 2, this is where it started, and at some point it reached us. None of us have met Peter. None of us have met Paul. But the message just kept moving. It went from Jerusalem all the way to different parts of the world, and the message kept on moving until it reached you and I. There are several books that have been written that have gone out of print. You can't even remember the author. But there's one message as long ago that they started preaching it, that it is still saving souls, still changing lives. And if we would just allow the Spirit to use us, we will continue to build the kingdom of God. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. There was a fire burning on the inside of these apostles, that same Holy Ghost who set the world on fire then is still alive in us. It's time for us to get out of that mentality that it's your pastor's job to minister to the world, that it's the preacher's job to speak and be a witness for Christ. It's the deacons who do the praying and talking to folk. Listen, if you're a child of God, the commission that Christ gave applies to every believer. That means if you're 10 years old and you believe in Christ, you got something to share. You may not understand it all, but something grabbed your heart. A 10-year-old can witness to another 10-year-old. However the Spirit moves, and we know God does things according to his divine plan. However he so chooses to use you, you ought to be willing to be used by God. It is through his church as we just looked at in Acts chapter 2. It was through the church that other people were touched and the gospel message spread throughout the world. But it started with those original believers. And they went out and they did what God had called and charged them to do. You and I, in 2021, need to go out and do what God has charged us to do. And when we share our faith, unashamed of the gospel, when we share our faith, God in his due time, he'll grip the heart of a person and accept them into the body of Christ. Listen, it's not our job to try to get them into heaven. Sometimes we feel, you know, that we're not being an effective witness because as soon as we share the gospel, they didn't accept Christ right then and there. Well, listen, how many of you all here accepted Jesus Christ as Lord the first time you heard the gospel? So what we have to do is just be consistent and keep spreading the good news and watch and see what God will do. Let us pray. Master, we come now in Jesus' name. We thank you. We bless your name, Lord. We give you honor and glory. Lord, we thank you of reminding us by way of your word on today that we are filled with the Holy Spirit. He is alive in us. And that we can do what you have called us to do if we just surrender our will to your will and let the Holy Spirit have his way. And Master, we pray right now that if there's someone here today or someone watching us via Facebook Live, if this same spirit in which we speak of today convicts their hearts, we pray, Father God, that they would just surrender their life to you. Get involved with a Bible-believing church so that they can live for you and help build the kingdom of God. Father, we pray for every person in the room and those tuning in. We pray, God, that you would just bless, Lord. Lord, we thank you for what you've done, what you're doing, and what you will do. We give you praise just for being God and being God alone. And we thank you for the Holy Spirit. It's in Jesus' name we pray and ask it all. Amen. Amen. We dare not bypass the opportunity to extend the invitation to discipleship. We don't want to assume everyone in the house is saved. There may be someone who is tuning in and you feel the Spirit of God speaking to your heart. Listen, you don't have to be in the building to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. And as we typically say, you can come by letter, Christian experience, or a candidate for baptism. But all the Lord wants you to do is come. Would there be one today? If you feel the Spirit of God speaking to your heart, listen, don't put it off until tomorrow because tomorrow's not promised. But if you're here and you feel the Spirit of the Lord speaking to your heart, you can come.
Thank you, deacons. Come on, let's give the praise team a hand on today, reminding us that better days are coming. Amen. If we just keep our hand in the Master's hand, everything is going to be all right. Amen. We thank God for the word on today. We thank him for the prayers. We thank him for the song. We thank him for the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And just in case there was someone that's tuning in via Facebook Live that accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, our prayer is that you would unite yourself with a Bible-believing church. You are more than welcome to join us here at Greater Rose of Sharon. But if not, listen, get yourself into a church where you can learn about the Lord and continue to serve him. Amen. Amen. At this time, this being our first Sunday in the month of May, we are going to observe the Lord's Supper. Amen. We want to make sure everyone has received their sacrament. Want to make sure everyone has one. Amen. Everyone good to go? Amen. 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 Before we take of the Lord's Supper, we're going to have a word of prayer. Let's bow. Father, we come now in Jesus' name, thanking you for the sacrifice that you made upon Calvary's cross. For you told us in your word as often as we can to do this in remembrance of you. And Lord, we remember, we're ever mindful of how you hung, bled, and died, and rose again on the third day with all power in your hands. And Father, we thank you for being obedient even to death on the cross. We thank you, Father God, for rising with all power in your hands. And Lord, we will be ever mindful of the sacrifice that you made on our behalf. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We bless your name, Father. It's in Jesus' name that we pray and ask it all. Amen. 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 At this time, let us eat and drink together. Amen. After the disciples partook of the Lord's Supper, he departed to the Mount of Olives. We won't give a benediction on today. We have our own various destinations that we will depart to. After our finance committee comes to us, we will consider ourselves dismissed. God bless you and keep you is my prayer.
What time is it? It's giving time. And it's good to give, for giving is ordained by God. For he said in his word, bring your tithes and your offering to the storehouse, that my house may have meat. And that tells me God intended for his house to be supported through tithes and offering. Not chicken dinners, fish fries, car washes, or rummage sale, but through tithes and offering. So let's just do it the way God says do it. Give and give your best and be blessed. For he also said in his word, he will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing you won't have room enough to receive. Now, to give to this great ministry, simply download the GiveLify app. That's GiveLify. Again, that's GiveLify. Go ahead and create your account. Enter the place of worship, Greater Rose of Sharon Missionary Baptist Church. Enter the amount you wish to give. go ahead and enter that credit card and billing information. Then tap that Give Now button and smile when you do it, because God loves a cheerful giver. Now, if you do not wish to use the Givelify app, you can mail your check or money order to Greater Rosa Sharon, Missionary Baptist Church, 2823 Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, Little Rock, Arkansas, 72206. Again, that's Greater Rosa Sharon, Missionary Baptist Church, 2823 Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, Little Rock, Arkansas, zip code 72206. And remember, Greater Rosa Sharon is a 501c3 charitable organization. All your tithes, your offering, and any donations are tax deductible. Until the next time, this is Deacon Duffy saying, God bless you and keep you, is my prayer.